know, George, there are so many people that are talking about preparing the body of Christ right now. Mm-hmm. And one asks, preparing for what? I mean, I believe that's preparation for the bride, preparation for the return of Christ. What do you think about that?
Well, it is a hot topic. You hear a lot of people talking about it. And I also hear people talking about preparing for revival.
What does that mean?
I was up with our good friend Cameron Yarai the other day up in Moravian Falls, and we began a discussion on that. And I shared my opinion. It's my opinion. I don't know if it's biblical, sure. But it's revival in our own lifestyle, in our own hearts, of preparing the way for the Lord. But also, you know, we read in Hebrews 11:1, faith is now. Mm-hmm. Now faith is the way it is. It's the now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And, you know, I believe that we were created to enjoy God.
I think so, too.
And it is in that rest that we enter into his promises.
Amen.
And that peace of God that overcomes the enemy, and that peace that cannot be shaken.
So that's really good. But what does it mean, though, then, to prepare people and to help them have that personal revival? I mean, I think that's the idea of, what does that mean? What does that look like?
Well, I think it looks like a lot of things. We need to know the Lord. We need to draw closer to him. We need to hunger and thirst for him. And then we have God's word. You know, Jesus is the word.
Yeah.
And he's alive, and his word comes alive. As we get into his word, I think that is one of the best ways to prepare ourselves for the coming age, and also the best way to prepare other people is through study of the word that is alive. And he's hidden his word in our hearts.
That's good. You know, we recently had Etienne Blom talk about ruling from Zion, mm-hmm. because the Lord rules from Zion. And the Lord gave me Hebrews 12 as a way. How do we access the Lord in that regard? And Hebrews 12 gives you those, I believe, the steps. And we've talked about that some already. Mm-hmm. But as you look at that, and as you walk in peace, first of all, and then you understand and identify with the death and resurrection, meaning that I die to myself, repent, and forgive, and I experience resurrection. Then I understand that I can't have bitterness in my life. I need mm-hmm. to let go of that. And Joseph is the perfect example of that, because Joseph looked over his life and realized, oh, this was all meant for good. Mm-hmm. And that's what Romans 8:28 is, all things work together for good. And so then as I put that to rest, and then as I go further and I understand Esau and Jacob, meaning that I have to understand that the temporal is not the goal. It's the eternal that mm-hmm. I have to go after. And I'm willing to run with all my heart. Then I'm into that place of life, not law. Mount Zion, not Mount Sinai. And I'm in that place with God. But then my question kept coming up. But for what reason? Is it just for me to have this great experience with God? Because a lot of people just run into that quiet time and just want to have their hearts filled up and not experience the fullness of God to be an overflow. You know, I keep thinking that, I keep hearing that song, Fill Me Up, Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And that we're overflowing, that we sweat Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we sweat the Lord. And so it becomes more like a, you know, I go out, wherever I am, I'm creating an atmosphere.
Mm-hmm.
And the Lord is inviting people in, and I'm hearing God. And I feel like our school is that place that mm-hmm. we make room for God.
Amen.
And so as I'm hearing the Lord there, and I go out into the highways and the byways, if you will, the Walmarts, the, you know, the Wendy's, the McDonald's, wherever I'm going to be, then I'm sweating Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
People can feel that.
Yes.
And I hear the Lord then speak more clearly, because I'm so filled up. I want to share that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I remember my daughter, when she was really little, said, Mommy, did you ever just go get so filled up with God you had to go tell somebody? I don't think everybody gets that way. I feel like sometimes I just want to hug people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's that love that overflows. But I believe it's in our overflow that is extending kingdom to people.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's not just about me.
No.
It's not just about me having a great experience with God, but it's about me in that place where I can overflow his heart.
Yes, it's really true. Those are beautiful words and a sentiment of a transformed life.
That's right.
Of someone that has experienced, and we're all going through this process of dying to self and seeking the Lord, and we hunger and thirst for his righteousness like the deer pants for the water. You know, it's like we're desperate for the presence of the Lord, for more encounters of knowing who he is.
But that change has to change not just me, but the people around me.
Amen.
Don't you think?
It will, but it starts within.
That's right.
It starts within us. You know, and I'm reminded of Peter and Paul, that a shadow or a handkerchief could heal. Or like Smith Wigglesworth, 100 years ago, he was so full and overflowing
Amen.
With the love of God and the
Amen.
Presence of God that he could walk onto a train or a subway car or a bus and people would be slain in the spirit. And they didn't even know who he was. He didn't even need to speak. It was his presence that he
That's
carried
it.
Of
That's
God.
It.
And he would be the first to say it's not him, that it's all about Jesus yeah. in him. Jesus Christ, the hope of glory that is in us. And as we're more full of him,
yeah.
then it overflows.
That's right.
And I remember a story I read about D.L. Moody one time reading a nighttime story to his granddaughter. And he was reading from the Bible. And she said, "Grandpa, why do you read the Bible every day?" And he said, "So that I can be full of the Holy Spirit."
Amen.
And she said, "Why do you need to do it every day?" And he said, "Because I leak."
That's right. Leaky Christians.
And so we can leak through getting distracted with the busyness and the cares of the world.
Right.
And we can leak from the overflow of God's presence in our life.
That's right.
So we need to have discernment about how we're leaking
right.
and who and where we leak. And then how do we get refilled and restored every day? One thing I remember Chen talking about several times over the last few years is that he sleeps some nights not at all.
Right.
And some nights, many nights, 2 or 3 hours a night, because he doesn't want to miss what the Lord has for him. And with that comes a supernatural energy. I remember about 10 years ago having a casual time with Rick Joyner. And we were talking about rest and the importance of rest, and then also supernatural energy. And we ended up that conversation basically saying, when we're really having these God encounters, it's like you could have been up for 18 hours
That's right.
or 2 days straight, whatever, traveling or speaking against the jet lag setting in after an international trip. But it's when that supernatural energy and the presence of the Lord is there, it is really amazing of how energized we can be.
Well, you're in the glory, and when you're in the glory, you get filled. And I don't care. Sometimes I don't care about eating or sleeping because I'm so filled up. But I think the goal is not just, you know, we need to get filled up. God is inviting us into his presence to drop the baggage and to go higher with him. And then we do get filled up, and then we overflow because it's kingdom. And this is where the tsunami of his presence, people talk about the tsunami and presence of, the tsunami of people are coming in, but they're forgetting. There's a tsunami of his presence that's coming. And I keep seeing that, and I feel like, okay, if the tsunami of God's presence comes, are we containers that can allow overflow in our lives mm-hmm. to let that happen and flow into the people? I feel like that's really important to understand. So to prepare people to receive more of him, to prepare them to climb Mount Zion, to drop the bags, to get filled up with God, to allow him to increase that place in us, I think is so important. I think it really is. And as we're doing that, the other night, one of our students, Janice, was talking about, I may mess this up, the pottery, nitsugi, am I saying that right? What that is, you know, you'll have broken pieces of pot,
mm-hmm.
and what they do is they glue them back together, and they put gold, they line them with gold, and it makes it more valuable of a piece.
Mm.
They're more solid, but they're also, they have gold on them, and this is the most incredible thing, because that's what happens to us. God's glory does fill us, and he heals us, heals those broken pieces, and he puts us back together, and we're more valuable after he puts that back together with his gold.
Amen.
That's an amazing thing.
There are so many tales and parables in the Bible about brokenness and how that happens. And you read about the life of Paul or John, who were imprisoned and crucified, and I'm always reminded daily of Philippians 3:10, of that we would know the fellowship of the sufferings of Christ so that we would know the power of the resurrection.
That's right.
That we have this resurrection life that, you know, we're in these clay vessels just for a season, a couple generations, 70, 80, 90 years, 100 years for some, we're claiming. but as long as the Lord wants that, we would be useful to him. And Nancy, you were saying something earlier about living for eternity, and of how, as we're in the presence of God and in the glory realm, so to speak, time shifts and changes, and we can experience eternity from where we are in the temporal. And we're created as these spiritual beings to occupy the temporal, where we are now, where we're seeing and speaking with our audience, and also we're seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus now and forever. And as we discover and allow the Lord to reveal to us our identity that we have in Jesus Christ, we can exercise more of that peace and that supernatural faith, knowing that this earth is not our home, that our real home is in heaven for all eternity, eternity past, eternity future, and that it's outside of time and things look differently. And, you know, we were talking a moment ago about the pottery and the gold, and how we each have faced trials and tribulation or persecution in different ways. But we need to be a little bit, I think, I know I do, more mature when trials come, because we can allow offense to take root.
Yeah.
And that could cost us years over some root of bitterness that hinders us from walking in the fullness of the joy of the Lord as our strength and the fullness of what his plans are. And so if we take everything that happens to us, good and bad, and when it comes in terms of the bad, of we take that before the Lord and we ask him, Father, show me what you are teaching me through this.
Romans 8:28, like I said.
There you go. And
Joseph,
how it all works together, and the life of Joseph. And we see that this is all preparation, that he is training us for reigning with him for all eternity, and how we steward our experiences and our reactions and turn that into faith and wisdom and discernment. We can grow and learn, and then we can share with other people of that wisdom that's not our wisdom, but it's the wisdom from God of how we can help prepare the bride and the end time church for the victorious victory that we have.
Well, you were talking about the pieces. You know, it's in the crushing that the anointing comes. Mm-hmm. Out of the Lord's wounds came healing for the nations. And I know that we don't like to be crushed.
Right.
But everybody's praying for anointing. They're wanting more anointing. It's through that crushing that we see the oil, that we see the wine that comes out. It's through our pain that when we understand it in the way that Joseph did, mm-hmm. and we look at that whole picture, that the Lord can actually take us to that higher place when we're not complaining and crying about something because we've been defrauded, but we're going to the Lord and we're saying, God, what did you want to do with this?
Mm-hmm.
And so that's climbing that Mount Zion to rule and reign with God.
Mm-hmm.
And so all those things, I believe, you know, we don't just all of a sudden automatically get there. This is a place of maturity, like you say.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a place of embracing my life, because it doesn't look like somebody else's. You know, my life doesn't look like yours, and my life doesn't look like yours. And it just, this is where I have to say, okay, Lord, this is what you've given me. What would you like to do with it?
Mm-hmm.
And we invite you, I invite you in to not only the school, to have room in the school to be, for the school to be what you want it to be, but also into my life. Like,
mm-hmm.
Lord, what do you want my life to be?
Really?
And my victory and success is not like, it doesn't look like somebody else's.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the great part.
Amen.
You know?
Amen. And I was sharing with some friends this morning, Nancy, that every day and every breath is a gift from God.
That's
and,
right.
And so it's like in Joshua, choose this day whom you will serve.
Amen.
As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Amen.
And it's not easy. There's no guarantees. We just know that if we believe that Jesus is Lord in our hearts and we confess with our mouth, then we shall be saved. And we can walk in this simplicity and the fullness and the power of the gospel and walking out the joy of the Lord as our strength.
A grateful heart.
A grateful
heart. Having a grateful heart. I think that's so key.
Yeah.
And so maybe we should just pray for everybody to Lord.
Go ahead.
Well, Lord, I just ask you, Father, that you would give us all revelation, that deep revelation, Lord, of a grateful heart.
Mm-hmm.
Father, I want to thank you just for today, Lord, for the rain, for the day, for the friends, Father, for everything that you've given us. Father, that we can be alive at this time, that we embrace each one of our lives, Lord, with a grateful heart. With every breath that we have, Lord, that we give you thanksgiving and praise and honor for everything that you've given us this day. Lord, this is just the groundwork. I see the Lord just laying a groundwork like it's gold. These are gold bricks for you to walk on. Each person as they hear this, Lord, that they would have that gold of a grateful heart. And Father, that this would be a life walk out in the name of Jesus.
And Lord, we just speak into the life of everyone listening to this and to their home and their family and their ministry. And as Nancy was praying, I was seeing, you know, we read in the New Testament about them bringing a crippled man on a stretcher into a house that was full of people hearing Jesus, and there was no room and they wouldn't let him in. And so the four men went up on the rooftop and opened up the roof to lower that paralyzed man down into the presence of Jesus. And I just see and speak that the hunger that's in your heart to see the Lord meet you at the point of your need, wherever that is, whatever situation it is, that I see you like lifting up that body and bringing it down through the roof, that you're so desperate for the Lord that you'll do anything to get in his presence. And like we read that when the woman that had the issue of blood for 12 years, she was so hungry to touch Jesus that she reached through the crowd and he said, who touched the hem of my garment? That, Lord, we just thank you for our friends around the world in America and Canada and those missionaries of ours serving in 70 nations and their families and our precious intercessors and our partners, Lord, that we're hungry and we're thirsty for more of you, God.
More of you, Lord.
And that we just want to reach in and touch the hem of your garment, Jesus, to behold your glory, to understand. And in Isaiah 2, I think 3 or 4 or 6 verse, it talks about, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord on Mount Zion.
Amen.
And Lord, you teach us your ways.
Teach us your ways.
And Father, that we're all your students. None of us have arrived.
That's
only
right.
Jesus is perfect. And we look to the perfect Savior, the Messiah, the healer, the deliverer, our advocate, our all in all, our high priest, our chief intercessor, who sits at the right hand of the throne of God, night and day, interceding on your behalf and on our behalf. And we just give you glory, Lord, for who you are, sovereign, full of majesty. We stand in awe, and we thank you for your extravagant love that you have for those hearing the word and entering into your presence today as you're preparing each of us, Lord, for this end time season, and you're preparing your bride. And Father, we just thank you, Jesus,
Lord,
that you are the head and we are the parts of your body, working together for your glory, Lord. Have your way. Here we are. Use us and send us.
Amen.
In Jesus' name, God bless you.